So now we're going to move on to a fascinating area called social psychology. Social psychology is probably one of the most important things our field has contributed to general knowledge and understanding of human beings and their behavior. So if you never take another psych class but one, I would recommend social psychology. If you take two, I'd recommend social psychology and behavior modification. If you take three, you might want to become a minor or a major because you're really into psychology. This has a lot of practical knowledge that I think is very valuable for you to know in your daily life so that you understand why people do what they do, because they're so vexing at times. We wonder why people seem so obstinate, or why they seem so passionate, or why they can't be convinced of things. And social psychology has some answers and prescribes for us some solutions. I'll just go through a few of these things pretty quickly because these are some basic concepts that are core to understanding what social psychology is about. We just did personality psychology. And personality psychology says that you have some core constructs within yourself that are traits, that are characteristics, that are things that are very consistent about you that people bank on. That's how they describe you. That's how they understand you. That's how they decide if they like you or don't like you, et cetera, et cetera. And those things are things we can say are who you are. And they should predict your behavior in a lot of situations. But throughout the course of psychology, as data began to amass, some researchers found that there were certain situations, as we'll see with some classic experiments, in which people's behavior would be nothing like you would predict based on their personality. They would do things that they themselves couldn't believe they would do later. And what we saw was a picture emerging that the situations people find themselves in are powerful predictors of behavior, right? Over and above, and sometimes in contrast to what we consider to be personality. It almost killed personality psychology, because what you saw with personality psychology was some modestly strong correlations across stuff in regular life, but then you would put people in these weird, novel, dramatic situations, and they would act unlike what their personality profile would suggest. And so some people suggested, well, maybe personality is just not a very good predictor of behavior. The pushback came when you realized that people aren't usually in novel and dramatic situations. They're in day-to-day life. And in day-to-day life, personality is a pretty good predictor of behavior. But in dramatic and unusual situations, the situation itself has a force, and that force is intangible, and it works in a way to shape people's behaviors in ways that they themselves may be uncomfortable with, or then would justify in ways by skewing their interpretation of the situation. So one thing is, we're cognitive misers. We don't like to change our beliefs. Once we get them, we believe in them, we feel them, we hope and pray and believe that what we see is the worldview we have is correct. We assume that our judgments are very good judgments. There's very few people like, man, I just don't know if I have any good judgment at all. Those people might be depressed. There's a few of them. But most people have great confidence in their judgments about the world and especially about other people. They think that they can sum up large, complicated phenomena in just a few concepts or sentences, and that conclusion is as valid as anything anybody could draw. That's a normal human being in the world. Cognitive miser says that once we've arrived at our conclusions, whether they're our values and our beliefs, or our judgments, our worldview, our schemas, that we don't change them. We are resistant to changing them. That's not a bad thing per se. We don't want values to change willy-nilly and fluctuate. Values are seen to be bedrock characteristics of humanity, right? And they matter. But at the same time, once we arrive at conclusions, we oftentimes will actually skew data that is inconsistent with our conclusion to make it consistent, rather than question our conclusion. So we just don't want to put forth the effort to change these things that are foundational to our understanding of our world. Schemas are very important in social psychology. We've talked about them before. We'll talk about them again. These are our categories of mind that help us interpret our world. We think in categorical manner. That can be very adaptive. As I've said before, I don't need to think long whether this is wood or whether it's a rail or whether this is a stage or whether that's a screen. That just happens automatically because these stimuli fit those categories. So I can move through my world very quickly using schemas to categorize everything and usefully categorize information such that I'm able to navigate my world and function very well. However, when we start working on looking at people and understanding much larger concepts, those can be limiting factors, because then we use the same categories to judge things very quickly, which are very complex. This being rail is not complicated. Whether or not a human being is a good human being, or whether or not a group of human beings are good human beings and things like that, or whether or not the economy functions in this way or that way, or what politics you want to espouse, or what kind of religion you want to be, those are very complicated phenomena. And they don't lend themselves to summary statements and judgments, but people make those all the time. So we have these schemas, which are our categories, which include all those labels we've talked about, and whatever's most available, you remember the availability heuristic, tends to be what drives our interpretations of situations. How accessible it is, how available it is, those categories of our mind are how we perceive the world, and once we perceive it, that then sets in motion a cascade of thinking effects that then result in behavior. If I interpret somebody as aggressive, I may react passively, or I may react aggressively, right? But if I'm another person and I interpret their behavior as assertive, I may have a wholly different interpretation, and a whole different set of behaviors may flow forth. So the way that we interpret the world matters. And social cognition is the idea that we think about the world in a social way. It's built on and guided by these concepts, these schemas that allow for classification of objects, people, and behavior and events, and permits quick communication. But it also leads us open to misinterpretation of one another